Dear CBCP family, it's been a year since we've gathered in our Discipleship Center, and we still need to wait until it's safe to do so. But we won't let that stop us from celebrating our anniversary this year. That's right, on April 4, 9:30 a.m., we will celebrate on the same day at the same time. Tune in to our YouTube channel or our Facebook pages as a live premiere of our special anniversary worship service will be aired. We will praise and worship through songs, listen to the testimonies of our brothers and sisters, and respond to a special message to our church at this very unique time. Mark your calendars, that's April 4, 9:30 a.m. Let's worship and celebrate CBCP's anniversary dynamic at 34.
Good day, CBCP family, to all of you watching us online today. May the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you and your family. As we prepare our hearts to worship our God, let us listen and reflect on this song of thanksgiving, Psalm 30, verses 1 to 5. I will exalt you, Lord, for you lifted me out of the depths and did not let my enemies gloat over me. Lord my God, I called to you for help, and you healed me. You, O Lord, brought me up from the realm of the dead. You spared me from going down to the pit. Sing praises of the Lord, you, his faithful people. Praise his holy name, for his anger lasts only a moment, but his favor lasts a lifetime. Weeping may stay for the night, but rejoicing comes in the morning. Let us praise the Lord.
The King above all kings. the grave, where these that left their house lay, where these that came to conquer the grave. Lord of all creation, of water, earth, and sky, the heavens are your tabernacle. Glory to the Lord on high. God of wonders beyond our galaxy, you are holy, holy. The universe declares your majesty. You are holy, holy. Lord of heaven and earth, Lord of heaven and earth. Early in the morning, I will celebrate the light. When I stumble into the darkness, I will call your name by night. God wonders beyond our galaxy. You are holy, holy. The universe declares your majesty. You are holy, holy. Lord of heaven and earth, hallelujah to the Lord of heaven and earth. Hallelujah to the Lord of heaven and earth. Hallelujah to the Lord of heaven and earth. Beyond our galaxy, you are holy, holy. The universe declares your majesty. You are holy, holy. God wonders beyond our galaxy. You are holy. Oh,
Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for another morning, another day. The steadfast love of the Lord indeed never ceases. And you are faithful, O God. Thank you, Lord, for your mercies are new every day, every morning. And great is thy faithfulness. And Father, as we come before you, Lord God, we thank you for this opportunity that we can come together as one church and one family. Thank you, Lord, that we can come before you holy and blameless through the righteousness of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died on the cross for our sins. And through him, Lord God, you have called us, Lord God, out of darkness into your marvelous light, and you have adopted us, Lord God, and become part of your family. Thank you, O Lord, for your goodness and graciousness to us. And Father, for today, as we come before you, help us, Lord God, to listen to your word, open our eyes, open our hearts, and help us to hear your word. But more importantly, give us strength and courage, Lord God, to obey your word. Help us, Lord, to live a life that honors you and love others. Thank you, Father, for today. We welcome your presence. We welcome you, Lord Holy Spirit. Be with us, O God. All these things we pray in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Welcome to our online worship. Today's sermon is the second to the last message in our series entitled From Ruin to Glory. Nearly 2 years after Zechariah's night visions, God spoke again through the prophet Zechariah. It was God's answer to the question asked by a group of delegates from Bethel. They came to ask this question: do we have to continue our long-standing tradition of fasting every 5th month? Since the temple was already halfway done, these delegates wanted to ask if they still need to continue the fast that commemorates the destruction of Jerusalem and the Holy Temple. The people came only with one simple question, so they probably expected a simple yes or no answer. But to their surprise, God gave them a long 4-part answer, and here is what we've learned so far. Here is God's first response. God desires real worship, motivated by a genuine devotion and not rituals that are empty and self-serving. In other words, God will not accept our insincere worship. And here is God's second response. God desires worshipers who love people and who will listen to his word. Today, we'll look at God's third response found in Zechariah chapter 8, verses 1 to 17. And the title of our message for today is Do Not Fear, Do Not Quit. And I invite you to open your Bibles with me and follow along. God's first two responses back in chapter 7 are the words of rebuke and judgment. But the next two responses that God gave here in chapter 8 are words of comfort and encouragement to his people. And in this passage in chapter 8, Zechariah teaches us this lesson. Do not fear, because God will return. Do not quit, for the Lord will restore. Do not fear, because God will return. And do not quit, for the Lord will restore. Let's unpack this. The first, do not fear, because God will return. Zechariah chapter 8, verses 1 to 2. Then the word of the Lord of hosts came, saying, thus says the Lord of hosts, I am exceedingly jealous for Zion, yes, with great wrath, I am jealous for her. In this verse, God used an emphatically strong language to express what's in his heart. Listen to what he said in verse 2, I am exceedingly jealous for Zion, yes, with great wrath, I am jealous for her. Here's another translation. My love for Mount Zion is passionate and strong. I am consumed with passion for Jerusalem. I love this statement. Here God is expressing himself in his own words. How did God describe his love for his people? He gives us a picture of like that of a lover who has a strong and intense feeling for his beloved. In the Hebrew word, the word for jealous, that it has the idea of a person's face becoming intensely red because of deep emotion. And God tells us that his jealousy comes with great wrath. Verses 14 to 15. For thus says the Lord of hosts, just as I purpose to do harm to you when your fathers provoke me to wrath, says the Lord of hosts, and I have not relented, so I have again purpose in these days to do good to Jerusalem and to the house of Judah. Do not fear. Here is what God is saying to his people. Because they have returned to him, the direction of his wrath will now change. He tells them that the same fiery zeal that prompted him to punish them when they sinned will be the same intense passion that he will have in order to protect and bless them. And so God tells them, Look at the past. When I said I would punish your forefathers for their sins, I did what I said. But now I will no longer harm you. Instead, I will bless you, and you can be sure that I will do what I said I would. And therefore, do not fear. And God continues his promises in verse 3. Thus says the Lord, I will return to Zion, and I will dwell in the midst of Jerusalem. And here's the point. God said, do not fear because I will return to you. Do not fear because I will return to you. Now this command, do not fear, appeared two times in verses 13 and 15. And now what's the significance of God's promise that he will return to Zion? You see, before the Jews went into exile in Babylon, the prophet Ezekiel saw God's Shekinah glory leaving the temple. God's glory departed from the people of Israel, and that must have been the most tragic and heartbreaking news that the Jews had ever heard. And you can read about that in Ezekiel chapters 10 to 11. But now God tells his people that he will now return to them. The Jews in Zechariah's time had never known or seen God's glory because the Lord had left them before they went to Babylon. So imagine the joy and the excitement that the Jews must have felt when they heard this encouraging message from Zechariah, that the Lord will return. And what will happen when God returns to his people? He tells them four things that he would do. God said, I will remain. Zechariah 8 verse 3. Thus says the Lord, I will return to Zion and I will dwell in the midst of Jerusalem. God promises to stay and live with his people. And next, God said, I will reinstate. Again, verse 3. Thus says the Lord, I will return to Zion, then Jerusalem will be called the City of Truth, and the mountain of the Lord of Hosts will be called the Holy Mountain. Isaiah compared Jerusalem to the faithful woman who became a prostitute. Isaiah chapter 1 verse 21. Now see how the faithful city has become a prostitute. She was once full of justice. Righteousness used to dwell in her, but now murderers. And did you know that in Lamentations chapter 1, Jerusalem was also called the unclean city. But when God returns to her, the Lord promised that God will enable Jerusalem to reclaim her prestige. Jerusalem will no longer be called a rebellious or wicked city. Instead, Jerusalem will now be known as the City of Truth or the City of Righteousness. Why? Because God is the God of Truth who will be in her midst. And also, the mountain of the Lord of Hosts will be called the Holy Mountain. Why? Because the Holy God will reside and rule there in her midst. And this promise is similar to what God said and has spoken through the prophet Isaiah. Isaiah 1:26. I will restore your leaders in the days of old, your rulers as at the beginning. Afterwards, you will be called the City of Righteousness, the Faithful City. And here's the third thing that God says he will do. I will revive. Zechariah chapter 4 verse 5. Thus says the Lord of hosts, old men and old women will again sit in the streets of Jerusalem, each man with his staff in his hand because of old age, and the streets of the city will be filled with boys and girls playing in its street. This scene is one of the most beautiful pictures of God's kingdom that you will ever find. Now, what's the significance of the elderly and the children? You see, these two age groups are considered the weakest and the most defenseless people in society. When Jerusalem fell into the hands of the Babylonians, the prophet Jeremiah made this lament. I have cried until the tears no longer come. My heart is broken. My spirit is poured out in agony as I see the desperate plight of my people. Little children and tiny babies are fainting and dying in the streets. They cry out to their mothers, we need food and drink. Their lives ebb away in the streets like the life of a warrior wounded in battle. They gasp for life as they collapse in their mother's arms. But here in Zechariah's message, God promised his people that someday the streets of Jerusalem would be filled again with young children and older people. Now understand that during this time, the walls of Jerusalem were still in ruins, so it was not safe for older people and younger children to be out on the streets. But God promised his people that when he returns, the young and the old will live in safety. Why? Because God will let them live in peace and security. Notice that the children in this vision are playing, meaning that they are worry-free. There's no war, no sickness, no calamities. Families are growing and the whole nation is thriving. This image gave comfort and encouragement to the remnant of the small Jewish population during Zechariah's time. And God gave them a vision of the future Jerusalem that enjoys peace, prosperity, and stability. And here is the fourth thing that God said. I will rescue. Verses 7 to 8. Thus says the Lord of hosts, behold, I am going to save my people from the land of the east and from the land of the west, and I will bring them back, and they will live in the midst of Jerusalem. The phrase from the east and from the west is an idiom meaning from all over the nations. We know from scripture and history that only a few exiles chose to return to the promised land. But God promises them that he will gather his scattered people and bring them back to the land of Israel. And for what reason? God says, and they shall be my people, and I will be their God. They shall be my people, and I will be their God in truth and righteousness. God is saying that this will not just be a physical gathering, but it will also be a spiritual one. God's people will not only have a change of address, but more importantly, they will have a change of heart. They will live in truth and righteousness. Now here's the point. God said to his people, do not fear because I will return to you. Do not fear because I will return to you. He promised to rescue, to revive, to reinstate his people, and he will remain with them permanently. Friends, this is the same encouragement that God has given us today. If you are in Christ and if you are part of God's people, then you have nothing to fear. For he says, do not fear, I will return to you. Now think about your life. What are you afraid of? Perhaps it's the recent surge in the number of COVID cases that we now have. It's been a year since we had our community quarantine and we still don't know how long will this pandemic last. Maybe you worry over your school or your work or your businesses that were severely affected by the quarantines. And then you're asking what would happen to you or your family or your work. Perhaps you or your loved one is sick and has an ongoing treatment and you ask yourself, will they survive? Will they recover? Whatever it is that you're afraid of, may we hear God's word of encouragement. He said, do not fear because I will return to you. You see, God promised that when he returns, we will live in safety and security. There will be revival and restoration. Now, some of you might be asking, will our circumstances change? Will things get better? You seem too good to be true. Is this for real? You see, these are the same sentiment that the Jewish had during Zechariah's time. But listen to God's assurance to those who are fearful and doubting. Zechariah 8, verse 5. Thus says the Lord of hosts, if it is too difficult in the sight of the remnant of this people in those days, will it also be too difficult in my sight? Declares the Lord of hosts. You see, God is telling his people, just because it's too difficult for you, it doesn't mean it's too difficult for me. God is saying, whatever is difficult for you, that is not difficult for me because I am a powerful, I am the Almighty God. You see, dear friends, many things seem difficult or impossible for us, but let us remember, nothing is too hard for the Lord and nothing is impossible with our God. God can bring his plans to pass and nothing can stop what he intended. For instance, how did the Jews return to their land? Where did they get the resources that they need to rebuild the temple? You see, it was God who moved the hearts of the two Persian kings, King Cyrus and King Darius, in two separate occasions, one in 538 BC and the other one in 520 BC. They were the most powerful rulers of the Persian Empire during their time, and yet God used them on separate occasions to show favor to his people. Ezra chapter 1 verses 1 to 2. Now in the first year of Cyrus, king of Persia, in order to fulfill the word of the Lord by the mouth of Jeremiah. This was recorded in Jeremiah chapter 32. The Lord stirred up the spirit of Cyrus, king of Persia, so that he sent a proclamation throughout all his kingdom and also put in it in writing saying, thus says Cyrus, king of Persia, the Lord, the God of heaven, has given me all the kingdoms of the earth and he has appointed me to build him a house in Jerusalem, which is in Judah. And many years after, the Lord also moved the heart of King Darius, and this is what King Darius said. Moreover, I issue a decree concerning what you are to do for the elders of Judah in the rebuilding of this house of God. The full cost is to be paid to these people from the royal treasury out of the taxes of the provinces beyond the river, and that without delay. I, Darius, have issued this decree. Let it be carried out with all diligence. Did you see that? God proved to his people that nothing is impossible with him. And this is one principle that we need to remember. What the Lord promised, he will accomplish. What God intended, he will fulfill. What the Lord promised, he will accomplish. What God intended, he will fulfill. And this brings us to the next part of what I want to highlight. This phrase, thus says the Lord of hosts. It's interesting in chapter 8 that this phrase appeared 10 times. And also the name Lord or Yahweh appeared 22 times. So the name of the Lord appeared almost in every verse of chapter 8. Now the question is, why this repetition? It's to make the point that God's word, that God's promises are sure. Scripture portrays that God is someone who can do the impossible and the miraculous. And this is the same thing that the prophet Jeremiah declared, Jeremiah 32 verse 17. O Lord God, behold, you have made the heavens and the earth by your great power and by your outstretched arm. Nothing is too difficult for you. Nothing is too difficult for you. Now back to our text. Did God fulfill his promises? Did he return to his people and restore them? Partially, yes. 75 years after the people finished the temple, the Lord God raised up Nehemiah, who rebuilt the walls of Jerusalem. And 5 centuries later, God himself returned to Jerusalem. Jesus Christ, who is the full image of the invisible God, he became flesh and dwelt with his people. However, the Jews rejected God once more. And as the song says, Jesus was scorned by the ones he came to save. But despite the sins of his people and their unfaithfulness, God remained faithful. And the Lord will fully realize his promise when Jesus Christ comes again, not only for the people of Israel, but also for those of us who are now part of his church. On the second coming of the Lord Jesus Christ, God's word would ultimately be fulfilled when Christ rules in his eternal kingdom in the new Jerusalem and in the new heavens and the new earth. And this leads us to our next point. Do not quit, for the Lord will restore. Do not quit, for the Lord will restore. Zechariah chapter 8 verse 9. Thus says the Lord of hosts, let your hands be strong, you who are listening in these days to these words from the mouth of the prophets. Those who spoke in the day that the foundation of the house of the Lord of hosts was laid, to the end that the temple might be built. God says to his people, let your hands be strong, let your hands be strong. In other words, God is saying, do not quit, but continue doing what I commanded you. And don't give up, but keep working on rebuilding the temple. You see, God promised, I will return. But he did not say, things will be easier now, so relax and there's no need to work. You see, God did not say that. Instead, God said, there's still a lot of work to do and you have to press on and be diligent. And what's the motivation for the people to keep on obeying the Lord and not quit? Verse 10. For before those days, there was no wage for a man or any wage for animal. And for him who went out or came in, there was no peace or there was no shalom or wholeness because of his enemies. And I set all men one against another. First, God told his people, before all of you experienced suffering and disappointment, there was no peace, there was no prosperity. And it was I who did these things because of your sin. But all these are about to change. Listen to what God promised to his people in verse 11. But now I will not treat the remnant of this people as in the former days, declares the Lord of hosts, for there will be peace, there will be shalom. Jerusalem means the city of peace, but it failed to live up to its name because of their sins, and that brought about God's judgment. However, God promised that when he returns, he will revive Jerusalem, and Jerusalem will reclaim her prestige. God will make Jerusalem the city of peace, the city of shalom or blessing, the city of prosperity and righteousness. And Jerusalem will again live up to its name. And what does this peace or shalom look like? Here's a snapshot of that in verses 12 to 13. For there will be peace, for the seed and the vine will yield its fruit, and the land will yield its produce, and the heavens will give their due, and I will cause the remnant of this people to inherit all these things. It will come about that just as you were a curse among the nations, O house of Judah and the house of Israel, so I will save you, so that you may be a blessing. I will save you, that you may become a blessing. What a great promise from the Lord. God said to his people, before there was no peace and prosperity, but now there will be peace and abundance. Before, you were a curse among the nations, but now you will be a blessing. In other words, God will restore the fortunes of his people. The Lord promised to reverse their situation, and he assures them that there is no one and there is nothing that can stop them from being blessed by God. Friends, God's message to his people back then is also the same message for us today. God tells us, do not quit doing God's work, for the Lord will restore. Do not quit doing God's work, for the Lord will restore. It's been a year since the pandemic had disrupted our everyday routine. It impacted our lives, our work, our ministry, and it has been challenging physically, emotionally, mentally, and even financially. And I don't know about you, but there are times that when I get overwhelmed by difficulties that I wanted to quit, I just wanted to give up. Maybe you're also at that point. You're discouraged and your hands are already tired of doing the work, especially the work you're doing for God. Why? Because many times the work is simply too hard. And what makes it more discouraging? More often than not, we don't see the results fast enough. There's no immediate reward for our sacrifices. In fact, the opposite seems to happen. Some of you are serving God, maybe as a parent, as a professional, as a business owner, or a ministry leader. Perhaps you work either behind the scenes or in the front lines. You experience discouragement because you feel unappreciated or misunderstood. And sometimes you feel that you're even criticized or even falsely accused. And I know this is a very disheartening encounter when we experience such things. But allow me to encourage you with the words of our Lord. He tells you and me, don't quit. Don't give up. Don't quit parenting your children. Don't quit teaching your students. Don't quit serving others. Don't stop praying for the sick. Don't stop praying for our nation and for our church. Don't stop loving your family. Don't stop loving your spouse. Don't stop sacrificing for your loved ones. Don't stop giving to the needy. Don't quit standing up for what is right and true. And don't quit trusting our God. Brothers and sisters, let your hands be strong and be faithful to do God's work. Even if it is hard, even if you're tired and there's no immediate result. Why? Because God promised that in his time and in his ways, he will bless you and he will use you to bless others. God is able to reverse your situation. He can restore your strength and peace, but you have to do your part. And what is that? Don't quit. So tell your seatmate, don't quit. Don't quit. Now let us remember what the Apostle Paul said in Galatians chapter 6, verses 9 to 10. So let's not get tired of doing what is good. And just at the right time, we will reap a harvest of blessing if we don't give up. Therefore, whenever we have the opportunity, we should do good to everyone, especially to those in the family of faith. May all of us not get tired of doing what is good. Now, going back to our passage, at the end of his promise to his people, God repeated this encouragement. Do not fear. Let your hands be strong. Do not fear. Let your hands be strong. Here in chapter 8 of Zechariah, the Lord gave all these beautiful and amazing promises to his people. And he said, I will. I will return to Zion and dwell in the midst of Jerusalem. I will bring back my people to dwell in Jerusalem. I will be their God and they shall be my people. I will not treat the remnant of this people as in the former days. I will save that you may become a blessing. But then, his people also have a responsibility to fulfill. And what are those? God calls them that the people are not to fear and they are not to quit and their hands are to be strong and do the work that God has given them. This is the people's responsibility and this is the same responsibility that God is expecting us to have. Do not fear, do not quit, let your hands be strong, and do the work. But when God said to them, let your hands be strong, He does not only want for their hands to be strong in terms of rebuilding the temple, not only that, but God also desires for their hands to be strong towards righteous living. God calls His people to be strong not only towards rebuilding, but also towards righteous living. Let's look at verses 16 to 17. These are the things which you should do. Speak the truth to one another. Judge the truth and judgment for peace in your gates. Also, let none of you devise evil in your heart against another. And do not love perjury, for all these are what I hate, declares the Lord. God calls His people to return to their covenant relationship with Him. And as we have learned last time, God desires real devotion and not just empty rituals. God is not concerned with the fast, but in faithful obedience. And this devotion is expressed in living righteously. As one preacher said, God desires holiness to be the hallmark of His people. God desires holiness to be the hallmark of His people. And what should God's people do? God gave His people the things that they should do and not do. God said, do this, speak the truth to one another and judge with the truth. And don't do this. Don't love perjury and don't devise evil in your hearts against each other. In other words, God tells them, do the things that I desire and don't do the things that I discuss. Love what I love and hate what I hate. God says to His people, love what I love and hate what I hate. And when they faithfully obey the Lord, when God's people become what God intended them to be, what will happen then? God said, they shall be my people and I will be their God in truth and righteousness. Dear brothers and sisters, God calls us to do the same. Think about your life. Do you pursue godliness? Are you living righteously? Do you do what God loves? And don't you do what God hates? Or is it the opposite? For example, do you speak the truth? Or do you lie just to please others? Remember this proverb, Proverbs 6, 16 to 19. There are 6 things that the Lord hates, 7 that are detestable to Him. Haughty eyes are a proud look, a lying tongue, hands that shed innocent blood, a heart that devises wicked schemes, feet that are quick to rush into evil, a false witness who pours out lies, and a person who stirs up conflict in the community. God hates these things, and so let us be careful with our words, with the words of our mouth, and even the motives of our hearts. Let our yes be yes, and let our no be no. Now here's another Proverbs. Proverbs 11:1. The Lord detests the use of dishonest scales, but He delights in accurate weights. The Lord detests the use of dishonest scales, but He delights in accurate weights. For those of you who run your own businesses, how honest are you in dealing with your customers, your employees, or even the government? Do you deliver what you promise to your customers? Do you pay your employees with the correct wages? And do you even pay the government with the proper taxes? May God help us. Recently, my friend, who is a businessman, shared me this story. His company is looking for a new security agency. And he said that he was surprised when someone asked him, sir, ano gusto nyo? Low-end, mid-end, or high-end? My friend was confused. And so he asked, so what's the difference? The other person said, if you get the low-end, sir, it's the lowest cost. But of course, the guards are underpaid. For the mid-end, the guards would get the minimum wage, but there's no benefit. But for the high end, it's the highest, and it's because of there's proper wage, and there's also benefit for the guards. So what do you like? So praise God, because my friend fears the Lord and he loves Jesus, he chose the right thing to do. He got the high-end price to pay the proper wages for their security guards. And more than that, my friend knows that doing this pleases the Lord. And I thank God for his life and his testimony. He did not quit making that godly business decision even during this time of pandemic and financial difficulty. He chose to do God's work faithfully, and he chose to obey the Lord, however hard it is. How about you? Dear friends, our God is the God of truth and righteousness. And so, as His people, let's do our best to reflect His image and live out God's character. So may God help us. Today, we've learned this lesson through the prophet Zechariah. Do not fear, because God will return. And do not quit, for the Lord will restore. And as we wait upon the coming of the Lord, may each of us encourage one another and keep on doing God's work. May our hands be strong as we serve the Lord and live for Him, and together we will rise up from ruin to glory. Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for the message of Zechariah. Thank you, Lord, for reminding us, Lord God, that you are the God who desires to return to your people. You desire to return to us because of your faithful promise that you want us to be your people and that you will be our God. And Father, we thank you, Lord God, that all of us, we can have this promise and assurance if we are in Christ, and we can look forward to the day when you return, that you will revive, you will restore, you will reestablish, you will reinstate, you will reform, and you will renew everything, Lord God, the loss, the devastation, the ruins. And thank you, Lord, that in the midst of this waiting, we can be assured, Lord God, that your presence is with us and we have nothing to fear. Help us, Lord, for many of us are tired of the work that is ahead of us. You know the crisis that we are facing. I pray, O Lord, for those who are weary and tired, Lord God, I pray that you help them, strengthen them, renew them, Lord God, with the second wind, Lord God. Allow them, Lord God, to run another race, Lord God, to run the second lap, the third lap, and just press on, Lord God, to follow you wholeheartedly. I pray for those, Lord God, who are afraid, who are weary, who are worried about tomorrow, Lord God, who have nothing and no one to turn to. I pray that your presence be with them. Surround them, Lord God, with people who would encourage them. Speak words of encouragement. Speak word of life to them, Lord God. I pray, Lord God, for those of us who are sick. We pray, O Lord, that you grant us your healing grace. Touch us, Lord God, with your resurrection power, and help us, Lord God, to experience renewal, Lord God, in our bodies, Lord God. Help us, Lord, to taste and see your goodness, Lord God, in this side of life. And Father, for those of us, Lord God, who are facing the daily struggles, Lord God, just help us, Lord, to focus on you, fix our eyes on Jesus. And may we have always that assurance that no matter what, Lord God, you will make all things, Lord God, beautiful in your time. You will make all things possible, Lord God. You will change things according to your purpose, according to your plans. Lord, let your kingdom come. Let your will be done. And help us, Lord God, as we face trials and temptations, Lord God. May you empower us, Lord God. May we do not fear. May you help us, Lord God, not to quit. But may you help us, Lord God, with your spirit, empower us, and let our hands be strong. Thank you, Lord, for today. Thank you, Lord, for your message, Lord God. And may you alone be glorified in our lives. Father, thank you so much. And as you continue to bow your heads, let me bless you. As you follow the Lord, may you love Him sincerely with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength. May you love and serve others as Christ loves you, knowing that He will reward you for your labor in the Lord. Now may the God of peace, God Himself, sanctify you true and true. And may your spirit, soul, and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. In the name of the Father, of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Thank you once more for joining us. I hope God's word will encourage us for another week. And I invite you right now to have your family talk. Share with one another what you've learned and think of ways how you can apply the specific things you've learned and apply it in your lives. May God bless us all. See you again next time.